Now, as we talked about earlier, that insisting on a smaller sin can oftentimes lead you into a much bigger sin, if you keep insisting on it. Imam Az-Zahabi, in his book called Al-Kabair, mentions some cases of people and their stories when they were at their deathbed. There was a man who was obsessed with chess. You know, when you play chess, he was obsessed with chess. Now, although chess is a game which uses your intellect and intelligence, but if you are obsessed with it and it's taking all of your time and keeping you away from the remembrance of Allah, it becomes a big sin. So since this man was obsessed with chess, at the time of his death, people told him, say La ilaha illallah, say La ilaha illallah. And he kept repeating, checkmate, checkmate. When he was supposed to remember Allah, this is now how he will enter in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by saying, checkmate. Then there was another man who was addicted to alcohol. And at his deathbed, when people told him to say La ilaha illallah, he kept saying, bring me the bottle, bring me the bottle. That let me have one last sip before I die. Imagine meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this state of disbelief. Ar-Radiya bin Sabura witnessed the death of an accountant or a treasurer who used to work with the financials. And he again was so involved with his work, or the work is something prescribed, but he was so involved with his work that even at his deathbed, he was repeating numbers and calculations. He couldn't think of anything else to say except numbers and calculations. And this is how he died. Although the people kept on telling him to say La ilaha illallah. Before you die, at least now admit La ilaha illallah. No, couldn't do it. Ibn al-Qayyim mentioned a man who couldn't say La ilaha illallah. Even though he tried, he could speak. He had the ability to speak. He was an eloquent speaker otherwise. But when the time came, when he was about to die, although people told him to say La ilaha illallah, he just couldn't say it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give him the tawfiq to say La ilaha illallah. Because all his life this man never lived by La ilaha illallah. He said it, but he never lived by it. So at the end, even though you might say it now and not believe it, at the end you will not even get the tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say it. This is how helpless we are. Really, this is how helpless we are. Shaykh Anwar al-Awlaki narrates the story of a religious scholar who visited a man who was on his deathbed, and since he was fond of a famous Arabic singer of our times, Kulthum, his family had put her music in a very loud voice on the tape recorder next to his deathbed, and he was listening to it, and the sound was really loud. And when this religious scholar entered his house, he said, what is this kufr? What in the world is going on? This, can't you see this man is dying? Put this music off and remember Allah. At least now remember Allah. And so the people switched it off and put on a cassette of the recitation of the Holy Quran. And as soon as that recitation was put on, the man started to scream, turn it off, turn it off. Put Kulthum back on because she soothes my heart. Astaghfirullah, can you believe it? This is a state in which he died. Because if you grow up on something, most probably the chances are you will die on that thing as well. If you grow up with a certain culture, with a certain belief system, you will die on it. And all your prayer, worship, whatever it is, will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you will not even have the tawfiq to remember Allah on your deathbed. How helpless we are as mankind and as Muslims. If you plan now that I will continue on and enjoy my youth, I will continue on with my life, and when I'm old and grey, that's when I'll do my tawbah, then clearly you are plotting against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are scheming against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine that. Trying to find a shortcut or an easy way out. That let me just enjoy life now, I don't care, I will follow it, yes I will follow it, don't worry about it, I will follow, but let me just enjoy life now, and when I'm a little bit older, that's when I'll start to really focus on Islam. But if you've lived your life focusing on the haram, then even on your deathbed, you will not get the opportunity to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us to worship Him, and that is why we have been sent. He mentions it in Surah Dhariyat, chapter 51, verse 56. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That I did not create jinn and mankind except that they should worship me. This is why we have been created, to be in remembrance and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we think we can try and deceive Him now. We can get involved with something else and try to deceive Allah by not following Him all our life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 54. وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرُ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plan and Allah plans. And Allah is the best of planners. So even though you might plot and scheme, know that Allah holds the key in the end. Big question now. We realize that we have sins around us. We are engaged in activities which are certainly very displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Question is, how do we get back on track? Get back on track individually and collectively. The answer lies in repentance. First and foremost, repentance. Not like repentance that you find in other religions, that you go to a confession box and talk to a father or a minister or a priest. Your confession is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Neither are we saying that you have achieved salvation because of certain things. That you, don't worry about it, continue to do sins. Somebody else has already paid the price for it. So you can do whatever you want. No, not like that. The first thing that you must do is feel remorse and sadness for what you have done in the past. The second is to stop doing it immediately and not to do it again. That is something logical. And you have to ask for forgiveness. You're not going to just get it. You have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nobody else for forgiveness of your past sins. And Allah ta'ala is then Ghafoor al-Rahim. If you are under the impression that you can sin and do a bit of good here and there every now and then, you know, and then at the end of the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you because He's Ghafoor al-Rahim. No, you've got to ask Him. You've got to beg and plead, and then He will accept your repentance. Because even the repentance to be accepted is something that lies with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has power over everything. And He may or may not accept your repentance. So you've got to really repent from your heart and swear never to do it again. Allah has promised you His mercy. He has promised you this. But according to a hadith from Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, the Holy Prophet peace be upon him mentioned that when Allah decreed the creation, He pledged Himself by writing in His book, which is laid down with Him, "My mercy prevails over my wrath." Allah Ta'ala's mercy is greater than His wrath. But you've got to ask for it. You've got to ask for His mercy. You're not going to just get it sitting around and doing nothing. You've got to genuinely make an effort in His direction. According to another famous hadith, we know the story of a man who was a mass murderer. He killed 99 people and then wanted to repent. He said, "I've killed enough people, now I need to repent." He was asked to meet a monk, somebody who did not have good knowledge of the religion. And when he went to meet him, the man said, and he asked him, "I want to repent." He said, "You repent? 99 murders? Are you kidding me? This is not possible. There is no tawbah for you. Go home." And that man killed the monk and made it 100. And now somebody then told him to go meet a scholar of religion. And when he went to meet him, the scholar told him that, "Yes, of course, the doors of mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are open even for you. You too can repent and Allah can forgive you." But so he was asked to leave his existing land and go to another place where people were believers and righteous. And on his way, the man died. And when he died, the angels started to debate. The angels of mercy versus the angels of retribution. The angels of accountability. The angels of accountability said, "He has sinned big time and he must be punished." the angels of mercy said, but no, he was on his way to seek repentance. So through his mercy, because Allah Ta'ala's mercy is greater than his wrath, he asked the earth to shrink. And the distance, which was more in terms of reaching the place where he had to reach, that distance was increased for him. And so when the angels came to measure it, they found out that he has been granted the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the key to remember is that this person was willing to change his environment. He was willing to change and leave that town and go towards the path of Allah and seek repentance.